Hello, everyone. It's a great Sunday. It's Mother's Day, baptisms, holiday clubs coming up soon. There's lots to be excited about. And we're in busy with this Elephant in the Room series, things we don't talk about. I almost wish we'd called it We Don't Talk About Bruno. And you know, this past week, Doe and I, we have had the craziest week. I want to say 2 weeks. And it has been, it's felt like I've moved from stress to distress to stress, back to distress, back to stress. And I'm so thankful for our small group and our friends and our family who've been praying for me and praying for us, and really for the Holy Spirit who has helped us get through every hurdle, and I'm very grateful. I'm sure there are more hurdles coming this next week, but God is good and I feel strong. And the reason why I share that is because it's so important to be aware and take care of our physical health and our emotional health and our spiritual health, but there's also our mental health. And that is what last Sunday was all about. When we hear mental health, we tend to think about it negatively, and we tend to think about the stigma that's around, that comes with mental illness. But mental health and mental illness, they are different. And we need to stay mentally healthy. And how we do that is by understanding stress. And it's also about how do we build that emotional resilience. It really was a great message last Sunday. The week before that was also helpful and interesting. And I'm going to try and say it the way Dolan told us to say it. It was called, "But it's legal." So if you missed those, then go onto our YouTube channel and catch up on those very, very good messages. So this morning, my elephant that I'm speaking into is called XX or XY. What does the Bible say about gender? Now, this word gender is a very hot topic at the moment. It has become the word that people use to place an identity or a label on themselves. So you might have heard someone say, "I identify as male," or "I identify as female," or "I identify as non-binary." And this is a way of speaking into how a person feels on the inside, regardless of their physiology or their DNA. In some way, it's a chance to stand up against gender stereotypes that someone might feel doesn't really fit them. They may not be the most masculine male or the most feminine female. And because of that, they can experience rejection, shame, and possibly gender confusion. Now, you might think, surely this doesn't affect anyone in Cochrane. But this idea of what is masculine and what is feminine actually needs to be spoken about. For parents who are raising children, for teenagers and young adults, and even adults who may be questioning how they feel about it. And I believe that God wants us to have a clear understanding of gender, to break ungodly gender stereotypes and expectations, and to strengthen identity, the identity that God wants for you and me. When we understand what the Bible says about gender, we'll be able to see ourselves the way God sees us. We'll be able to see other people the way God sees them, and we'll be able to treat other people the way God wants us to. So before you start getting too nervous, I'm going to start with two important things that you need to remember. First of all, biologically or genetically, there are two genders. There's XX and there's XY. XX is female and XY is male. You cannot change your DNA. That is how God has designed you. The second thing is that gender confusion, it's not about one's biological gender. It's when someone has the DNA of a specific gender, but that they feel they identify with the opposite gender or no gender at all. And this is different to sexual preference, and it's also different to gender dysphoria. This is an identity issue. So three questions that I want us to answer today. The first question is, what is the biblical view on gender identity? What does the Bible say? Why is Jesus male? And why is God Father? So let's have a look at what is the biblical view on gender identity. And this morning, my goal here is not to go into an in-depth study of gender and gender roles, but just to scratch the surface of something that I do believe the Lord is leading the church, not just our church, but the universal church, to grapple with, to engage with, and to be challenged by. So when we look at Genesis, that's the first book in the Bible, and we can even go to the first chapter in Genesis. It's clear that the Bible acknowledges two genders. In Genesis 1, verse 26 to 27, we read, "Then God said, 'Let us make human beings in our image to be like us.' So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them." So right in the beginning of God's word, it's clear that there are two genders. There's male and female. So there is a difference, a biological difference between the two genders. But if we read this verse again, the Bible also tells us that we are made the same. We're all made in God's image, male and female. This is speaking of who we are. This is speaking about our identity. And it's a powerful verse. Your nature, your personality, our characteristics, our qualities, what makes me me, your soul, your mind, your spirit, that is all made in the image of God. And all humans have this. It's what separates us from the rest of creation. So if we have a look at the next verse in Genesis, Genesis 1 verse 28, it says, "Then God blessed them and said, 'Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and govern it, reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and all the animals that scurry along the ground.'" Now this verse and the one before it is actually set before the fall. It's before Adam and Eve chose to reject God. It's before the curse. This passage speaks about God's intention for us when he created man and woman. He intended for both man and woman to reign and rule together over creation, a partnership between two different genders with the same purpose. Or else it would have said, only men fill the earth and govern it, only women reign over the rest of creation. It's a partnership. That was God's intention. So even though biologically men and women are different, God creates people with the same image in mind, in his image. And the original plan was for us to have the same task. So where do the different expectations of gender come from? So let's look at it like this. If I asked you to think about what makes a man a man, and I'm not speaking about physically, what makes someone manly? And then if I asked you to think about what makes a woman, what makes her womanly, feminine, what are the characteristics that come to mind? In other words, what does masculine look like to you? And what does feminine look like? Why is it that we can look at a woman and we can decide whether she's more or less womanly based on how she dresses, on her hairstyle, on her physical strength, on her softness, on her loudness, on the sports she plays? We kind of put her in a spectrum of how womanly she is. And the same goes with men. We look at how they dress, how soft they are, if they have nice handwriting, if they want to play rugby, if they can take the lead in a situation, or they let others take the lead, and we decide whether they are manly enough. We talk about how real men don't cry, or women are the weaker sex. But what does God think about all of this? Do you know, in our lives, Doe and I have actually defied general stereotypes in a couple of ways in our relationship, for the sake of our marriage and for our family. So when we got married, Dolan was still studying, but we wanted to get married. And so who was the breadwinner? Me. I was the one earning the income. It wasn't just for a month. It wasn't just for a year. I think up until the time Sasha was born, maybe even up until the time Kate was born. So when Kate was born, we'd been married for 5, 6, 7, 8 years. I was the breadwinner, bringing in the income. When the girls were born, who changed the nappies? Dolan. Who bathed the children? Dolan. Who read and still reads them stories? Dolan. Now, our fathers and their fathers, gosh, if our mothers and grandmothers had asked them to change nappies, they would have said, what, are you crazy? A man doesn't do that. And so in that way for us, we started off as a partnership with our parenting. As the girls got older, Dolan would let them do his hair with pretty elastics. But his hair was a lot shorter. So I think now it might cause knots and things, and there's no desire in them to do dad's hair anymore. Now Dodo will bake with them. He will also teach them, and he has taught them, how to use a drill and a saw, how to create things with wood. And interestingly enough, the Bible gives us insights into different types of men and women who defied typical gender stereotypes. So we read in the book of Judges of a woman, and I'm not sure how you say her name, I think it's Jael, and she made a decision which brought about the whole victory of the nation of Israel. She went and took a tent peg with a hammer, and she drove this tent peg into the captain of the enemy's army, into his head, and killed him. And then Israel got victory over the Canaanite king from that act. She was a fierce warrior. And I read this maybe about, I want to say about 10, 12 years ago, the first time I read the story, and I was like, oh my gosh, how hardcore is this woman? And it's there in the Bible. There's Bezalel and Oholiab, two men who God anoints to cut stones, but also to sew beautiful garments. They were talented and gifted sewers. There's David, the mighty warrior king, who also plays the harp, and he writes emotional and lovely poetry. But perhaps the greatest example of defying society's typical gender stereotypes is Jesus. Jesus, who entered the temple and was so upset by what was happening in the temple, he mustered up all of his strength. He drove people out of the temple. He kicked over the tables and the chairs. He stood his ground. And then the same Jesus, the same man who wept when his friend died, he wasn't embarrassed by his crying. He wasn't apologetic by his crying. He wept. He showed emotion. Jesus, whose own ministry was financially supported by businesswomen, he never felt threatened by the fact that women were supporting him financially. Jesus, the lion, strong and powerful, and the lamb, gentle and soft. I've been reading a book, and some of you have spoken with me about it. It's Taryn Williams' latest book, How God Sees Women. And he includes a study where scientists have identified 10 types of, or 10 spectrums of personality types found in people. And basically what the study did was took a group of people like this and was looking at the different personality types that you get, and then took it one step further to see how many men had certain personality types and how many women had certain personality types. So have a look at the results from this study. If you can go to the next slide then. So there's the range of the 10 personality types. We've got compassionate, polite, imaginative, enthusiastic, orderly, industrious, assertive, analytic-minded, stable mood, staying calm. Now, these are interesting personality traits because some of them, if you weren't to look at the percentages, you might assume would only apply to men or only apply to women. But if you have a look there, there might be more women or more men with a certain personality trait, but both men and women have these personality traits. If you look at industrious, it's 50-50. If you look at staying calm, it's interesting. It's 60% male. Does that mean women can't stay calm? Don't tell me! No, I'm joking. Doesn't mean they can't stay calm. It's just maybe more of a personality trait in men, but doesn't mean you don't get women who are calmer than men. It's the same with compassionate. Look at that, 61% female. But I can tell you, if you were to compare Dolan and I, he's way more compassionate than I am. And so I love the fact that there isn't one personality trait that has 0% female or 0% male and 100% female. This is very, very interesting. And this shows that personality traits aren't based on gender. And also what I like about this is that there aren't any weaker traits. If you look at these, you might think, do I really want my son or my daughter to have any of these traits? But personality traits are not weaknesses. These are characteristics of God Himself, and we are all made in His image. What if, as a parent, I can celebrate that the fact that my son is more compassionate and nurturing and not feel like it's going to question his gender? He could be a fantastic healthcare worker, teacher, father. Instead of feeling embarrassed that I have a son who is like that and isn't more like his more masculine brother. But what if I could also celebrate the traits of his brother? Maybe his brother is physically stronger, an excellent rugby player. What if I have a daughter who is assertive and could one day be a leader in her school? Instead of feeling ashamed that she can speak her mind, I can celebrate that that is who she is. That's how God has designed her. And maybe her sister might be softer, but she still has influence, and I can celebrate that, the softness in her. And I know she can make a difference in the world for Jesus. What if you have a very polite son? Does that make him less masculine? No, he could be polite and very analytical. These things actually aren't masculine or feminine. And we shouldn't be seeing the nature of our children as weak if we think their traits don't match their gender. Because this is what the Bible says about our identity. In Ephesians 5, verse 1, it says this: imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. We are to become more like Jesus. We are to guide our children to become more like Jesus, boys and girls, not according to maleness or femaleness, but according to the character of Jesus, the image of Jesus, His nature. We're to celebrate their unique design and giftedness and the personalities that God has put inside of them. Tell them you love them. Tell them you're proud of them. And we're to help them to become the men and women of God that He desires them to be. People who put Him first, who love Him with all their hearts and souls and minds, and who treat others the way Jesus would treat them. And so to parents who are concerned that your children or your child isn't manly enough or isn't girly enough, perhaps it's time to shift your focus on how to nurture your child to know and love Jesus more. Perhaps it's time to teach them that their identity is not based on gender, but on Jesus. And when we realize that our identity is in Jesus, it's much easier to accept how he's made us biologically. Remember, and this is a quote that comes straight from Taryn, the Bible never commands us to strive for greater levels of masculinity or femininity. Instead, we're called to greater levels of Christ-likeness. And so to anyone sitting here today who's unsure of whether you are feminine enough or masculine enough, know that God sees you. He knows you, he loves you, and he wants you to walk a journey with him that will help you to be confident of who you are on the inside, to find your identity in him, and to give you the confidence to accept who you are on the outside. Very quickly, I'm going to go and just quickly answer these next two questions. Why is Jesus male? Well, a lot of women, not a lot, you do find women who struggle with this question. Why did Jesus come as a man? And really, Jesus could only have, he only had two options. He could only be born a female or a male. So when he came to earth, he came as a man. And we need to understand that the world he entered, the world he came to, was, there was only one gender who really had a voice, and that was male. He came to a time in history where he lived in a severely patriarchal society. Women were not educated, or very few women were educated, especially in Roman culture. And so it was severely patriarchal. As a male, Jesus was an advocate for women. He used his voice to uplift women, to stand for women, to affirm women. And this never diminished his own maleness or his own masculinity or his own leadership or his own giftedness. Jesus was the ultimate and possibly the first example in history of someone who treated women by their identity, not based on their gender, as children of God. He didn't put limits on them or restrict them because they were women. And you know, Jesus was so confident in who he was that he didn't feel ashamed or self-loathing because he was a man. He didn't have man guilt. He was born XY, male, and his voice transformed the lives of men and women throughout history and is still transforming us. And to all the men who like Jesus, use your voice to uplift women, to support women, to show respect to women, who treat women and other men the way Jesus would want you to. May you know God's blessing and favor and strength and protection as you honor him by honoring the woman and the men in your life. The last question is, why is God Father? Now, you know, when people begin their journey of knowing God, they're first confronted with this idea that God is a father. Being father is not a question of male or female. God is not physical, but he is father. For some people, accepting God as father is very easy. Either it's easy because your own father was so loving and kind and treated you so well that it's easy to identify with the fatherness of God. Or your own father was so destructive and so awful that it's easy to accept a heavenly father who is completely unlike your own earthly father. Or it's a very hard idea to accept God as father, since your own dad was so, or is still so wonderful and amazing, it almost feels disloyal or impossible to see God as father too. Or your father was so dreadful that to accept another father, even a heavenly one, is a terrifying and difficult thing to do. And whether it's easy or hard to accept God as father, the reality is that humanity has a father crisis. And this isn't a new thing. And yes, there are families that are torn apart by destructive mothers, but the stats of fatherlessness are just that much higher. The number of lives damaged by fathers is just so much more than by mothers. And we only have to look at the statistics of our own province in the Eastern Cape to know that too many families don't have a biological father present. Or they have disinterested fathers, disengaged fathers, absent fathers, or abusive fathers. And the ultimate solution to this crisis is the healing that comes when you know God as your heavenly Father. Children, whether they're male or female, who know God as their Father, regardless of how their earthly father is, will grow up and be better spouses and better parents as they strive to become more like Jesus. Our heavenly Father God, He loves you unconditionally. He is always present. He is a listening ear. He is kind and He cares for you. He's interested in you. He is gentle. He is patient. He is willing to help. He wants to bless. What an amazing Father God is. In 1 John 3 verse 1 we read, "See how very much our Father loves us, for He calls us His children, and that is what we are." When we know God as our Father, we are blessed. Now, there are many wonderful fathers, even sitting here today, and I know it's Mother's Day, but I do want to mention you, because thank you for how you've loved and served your wife and your family in such a way that honors your own Heavenly Father. And to all the moms whose children don't have a father or don't have the father that you wish they had, God sees you and He loves you. As He's your Father, He desires to be your children's Father too. So keep praying for your children to know Him and to know His love for them. We're going to take a moment now just to pray. I ask you to just close your eyes with me. And Lord Jesus, I thank You that there is so much in Your Word that has answers to so many questions, questions we don't even think are possibly relevant in church. But how relevant is this? Lord, that we can accept how You've put us together, how You've designed us, because our identity isn't based on how we look on the outside, but it's who we are on the inside. That You accept us, that You love us, and that You want us to become more and more like You, Jesus. That our identity can be found in You. Lord, I thank You that You are such an incredible example of how we can treat each other, how we can respect each other, how we can see each other, male and female. I thank You, Lord, that it is so easy to follow Your example. I thank You that you were such a loud voice back then, but even now, as Your church, we are Your voice. And I thank You that the church is starting to speak up into these things. Lord, I thank You that we can know You, Father God, as our Heavenly Father. I thank You that You accept us, that You love us, You adopt us into Your family. I thank You that being Your child means that we can find healing, wholeness, confidence. Lord, that our whole lives can change from going in one direction to another. Thank You, Lord, for how much You care for us, how much You love us and want to bless us. And this morning, if you have never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, or given your life to Him, or asked God to be your Father, then we're going to say a prayer now, and I encourage you to pray this. We'll all pray it out loud, but really mean this in your heart. So let's pray it together. Dear Lord, thank You for dying on that cross. Thank You for laying down Your life so that I can be forgiven. so that I can be a child of God. I ask you this morning to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to be my Lord and Savior. I ask for you to adopt me into your family. Help me with this new life to be more like you every day. In Jesus' name, amen.